بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our previous lesson, we made an introduction about the chapter of selling transactions and other dealings as written by Al-Qadi Abu Shuja', who was a prominent figure in the school of Imam Al-Shafi'i radiyallahu anhu. In this chapter, Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' talks about the different types of transactions to indicate which transaction complies with the rules of the religion and which one does not. We did mention as well that unfortunately most of the dealings and transactions conducted these days do not comply with the rules of the religion. And when one gets involved in a transaction that does not comply with the rules of the religion, in some cases, the money gained from such a transaction is unlawful. So he is not allowed to use that money, and he has to return them to the other party. For that reason, one should give great attention to this chapter when learning about the different types of transactions and dealings. Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' said what means selling is the three types of transactions: selling an observed item and that is permissible, selling an item based on guaranteed description and that is permissible if the descriptions are found to be as described, and selling an absent item that has not been observed and that is not permissible. So here in this chapter, he's talking about different types of transactions. When you are selling and buying, you need to keep that in mind. Now, the first one, when one is conducting a sale, he might be conducting this on a present item that is observed by both the seller and the buyer, and that is permissible. Or he might be conducting a sale based on guaranteed description. And here we have two types of sales that go under this category. There is one type that is called as-salam, and we'll talk about this in detail later on, inshallah. But here we'll talk about conducting a sale on an item that is sold based on guaranteed description by the seller, when in fact the buyer has not observed the item. And the third type is when conducting a sale based on the item being absent and has not been observed. And we'll talk about this in detail, insha'Allah Azza wa Jal. Now, for any transaction, there are three integrals that must be fulfilled in order for that sale to be valid Islamically. Three integrals. First of all, al-aqid, the contractor. And that could be referred to the seller and the buyer. So that's the first integral. We need to have a seller and a buyer. They call this the contractor, the one who is conducting the sale. Keep that in mind. Seller and buyer. So if one is missing, then the transaction is invalid. Such as with details, when we talk about, you might think about buying an item from a vending machine. Now there is a buyer, but there is no seller. It's a machine. So here the transaction takes place between a human being and a machine. And many scholars talked about this in regards of missing this integral, that there is no seller in this case, the one who is conducting the sale, and that renders the sale invalid. So first, there must be a contractor, seller and buyer, both by which the sale is conducted. Second is as-sigha, the exchange of verbal consent. The exchange of verbal consent between the seller and the buyer. That's the second integral. Now, when talking about the exchange of verbal consent, this can be conducted by the seller saying to the buyer, I now sell you this item for such and such. That's the offer, they call the offer. Now the response by accepting this offer from the buyer is to say, I buy it from you for such and such. So we have the offer and we have the response by acceptance. Now it could happen by the seller starting conducting this sale in this way by saying, I now sell you this item for such and such. Then the buyer says, I now buy it off you for such and such. Or it could happen the other way around. The buyer will start making the offer by saying, I now buy this item from you for such and such. Then the seller would say, I sell it to you for such and such. So it can be valid in both ways. Either by the seller starting, making the offer, or the buyer starting by making the offer. Then the response by acceptance will be from the other party. Now, regarding the terms used, according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, the terms used must be one of the following. بِعْتُكَ, I now sell you this item for such and such. Or مَلَّكْتُكَ, meaning I transfer the ownership of this item to you for such and such. So he becomes the owner. So the meaning of selling is embedded in this sentence that the seller has used, or the like. Now the buyer would say, I accept, that's fine, or I buy it from you for such and such, and that is fine as well. It's not a condition that there is an agreement in the terminologies of both the offer and the response by acceptance. This means if the seller says, I now give you this item for such and such, so he didn't use the term, I now sell you the item for such and such. I now give you the item, this item for such and such. Then the buyer says, I accept or I buy it from you for such and such. That is valid. So it doesn't have to be the same terminology used by the seller and the buyer. Anything that would give the meaning of selling, making that offer, and accepting by responding to that offer by saying, I accept or I buy it from you for such and such, is valid. Now there is something that is called al-mu'ata'ah. Al-mu'ata'ah is a type of transaction that goes under the category of sale, but both the seller and the buyer do not exchange any verbal consent. It's based on the convention of people regarding purchasing such items. For instance, someone is selling some items, and each item, it's written on it, it's for $10. Someone took one item, he went to the cashier, for instance, he gave him $10, and he took that item away. They did not exchange any verbal consent. So this is according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, is invalid, because there must be an exchange of verbal consent. However, some scholars from the school of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and in the Hanafi school as well, they chose that such type of sale is valid, because it is understood according to the convention of people that as if he is saying, now I'm buying this item from you for $10, and that one took the $10, that means he accepted to sell it for that person for $10. So in both cases, it is understood that they both exchanged that consent by handing in. That's why they call it al-mu'ata. You hand in the money and the seller hand you in the item without exchanging any of the verbal consent in such a case, according to some scholars from the school of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, such a transaction is valid. But according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, originally such a transaction is classified as an invalid transaction. And this happens these days a lot. You go to a shop, you see some items and you see the price tagged on them. You just grab the item and you go to the cashier and you give him the money and you take the item. Just to let you know that according to some scholars, such a transaction is valid. But Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said, there must be a contractor, both seller and buyer. Second, the exchange of verbal consent. When we say verbal, that means it must be conducted verbally, not only by exchanging the item and the money without the exchange of any verbal consent. There must be, according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, the exchange of verbal consent. And also the third integral, what they are conducting the sale on, that is the item, for instance, that is getting sold. Some conditions must be met in such an item to be valid, to be sold. And we'll talk about this soon, inshallah, azza wa jal. Also, the scholar said, the exchange of verbal consent and that is according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, should not be interrupted by a lengthy interruption that indicates the other party is not accepting this transaction. Like if someone says, if the seller says, I now sell you this item for such and such. Now the other party did not reply, did not respond quickly by saying, I buy it from you for such and such. He remained silent. Let us say for half an hour, what does that indicate? That indicates he's not accepting the offer. So the seller has made the offer, but the buyer did not accept that offer immediately. So there was a lengthy interruption between the offer and responding by accepting that offer. Now that lengthy interruption nullifies the validity of such a transaction. Also, the seller and the buyer both must be entitled to conduct such a type of sale on their own. And that means, according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, it is invalid for the child who hasn't reached the age of puberty to conduct the sale. He can't do that. Even if he is 10-year-old boy, he cannot conduct a sale by himself. He is a child. Now, according to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah raise his rank, if the child is permitted by his guardian to conduct the sale, then that sale becomes valid if conducted by this child, because he has permission. So according to Imam Shafi'i, it's invalid for the child to conduct a type of sale by himself. Other scholars like Imam Ahmad chose the validity of such a transaction if this child is permitted by his guardian to conduct this type of sale. So that's something that you need to keep in mind. So usually if, you know, those students that go to school and they buy from the canteen, if they are mumayyizin, meaning they have reached the age of mental discrimination, not four, took about around seven lunar years. So they have reached the age of mental discrimination. Once they reach that age, if they are permitted by their guardians to buy and sell, then they are allowed. So when the father gives his son money, who is, let us say, 7, 8, to go to school and buy from the canteen, he will be conducting that sale on his own. But he is permitted by his guardian. The question is such a transaction valid? According to Imam Shafi'i, no. According to Imam Ahmad, yes, because the child is permitted by his guardian to conduct such a sale. So the buyer and the seller must be pubescent, according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and must be sane. So if an insane person were to conduct a sale, then that sale is invalid as well, because he is insane. Also, they said, the one who is banned from conducting a sale, because that has been enforced on him for a reason, because this person is not entitled Islamically to conduct such a type of transaction. And the scholars would talk about the person being entitled. That means he knows how to deal with his money Islamically, and he is not fool. So he knows what to buy, what would benefit him. And Islamically, religiously, his situation is accepted in such a case for that person to conduct a sale on his own. Because if there is a person, even if he is pubescent, and that's mentioned in the Quran, he is pubescent and sane. However, from the inheritance that he inherited from his father, let us say, he is spending his money in haram. And this is called at-tabzir, spending the money in haram. He's buying alcohol. He doesn't know how to deal with his money. Here the judge would freeze his money and would ban him as if he's putting him in quarantine. Maybe you're available, like you know about this term. As if he's putting him in quarantine until he becomes mature enough where he knows how to deal with his money. So they call this al-mahjur alayhi, meaning the judge has enforced on him the unentitlement to conduct any sale by his own, because he is not aware of what is beneficial for him in conducting such a sale. So he will be banned from conducting such a sale until he becomes mature, able to conduct the sale in the way that befits him. Also, both the buyer and the seller must be willful when conducting a type of sale. That means if someone is forced to sell his land, for instance, you know, sometimes those who have power, political power, or in the region, they have certain powers and they want a land from someone. Even if he doesn't want to sell, they force him to sell. So being under that force nullifies the validity of this transaction. So even if the buyer were to sell in that case, unwillfully, he is selling the item unwillfully, or the land unwillfully. He doesn't want to sell it, but because he is forced to sell it, he is selling it. Such a transaction becomes invalid. There is an exemption, the scholar said, when the judge, the Muslim judge, forces the owner of an item or a land or whatever to sell that item or that land in order to pay back the debts. Let us say he made an agreement with someone, he borrowed some money from him for a certain date, now it's a due date, and the owner of the money is asking for his money to be paid, and that one is refusing to pay him his money back. He complains to the judge, and the judge here will force him to sell the item. Now in such a case, he might force him in order to pay the debt back. Same when there is something that is put as collateral against a debt. Something that is put as collateral against a debt. Let us say someone wants to borrow some money. He might go to a person and say to him, I need to borrow, let us say, $1,000 from you. Then that one would say, I'll lend you the money. However, I need something to guarantee that you are going to pay me the debt back. He might say, I'll put my car as the guarantor in that case, that you will get your money back. So they will make that debt as, or that car as collateral, they call it rahan in Arabic, against the debt. Meaning, on the due date, if the borrower is unable to pay the money back to the owner, he needs to sell that car in order to pay him his money back. Now here the judge might force him to sell his car in order to pay the debt back. Now such type of enforcement by the judge is valid because there is a benefit here, which is to guarantee the money of the lender is returned to him. That's an exemption. But in general, if someone is under the force of selling his land, for instance, he doesn't want to sell it, then such type of sale is invalid. Such type of sale is invalid. So I'll repeat, there are three integrals for any sale to be valid. Contractors, and here we are referring to both the seller and the buyer, both must be entitled to conduct the sale, and that is to be pubescent, sane, and mature, knows how to deal with the money, and to conduct that sale willfully. And also the exchange of verbal consent, according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. And lastly, the item they are conducting the sale on must be Islamically valid to conduct the sale on it. And we'll talk about this soon, inshallah, azza wa jal. Because one of the jokes that you can say that I've read is that they were selling some stars to people and they name them after their names. You pay money and they sell you one star and they put your name on that star. They don't own the star to sell it in the first place. So here, the item they are conducting that sale on did not fulfill the conditions for valid and proper sale. In that case, it is invalid. Or something that has no benefit and so on. We'll talk about this soon, inshallah. So that's the first type. The second type, selling an item based on guaranteed description, and that is permissible if the descriptions are found to be as described. And here we have two types of sales, as we mentioned. The first one is called as-salam. As-salam is when the seller, we'll talk about this in detail, the seller does not have the item at present. However, he commits himself to provide the buyer with that item with known and guaranteed descriptions at a later time. This is called as-salam. So one will be handing in the money to the seller, and the seller will commit himself to provide the buyer with that item or the product with guaranteed descriptions at a later stage. And they specify the time, they specify the place, and so on. We'll talk about this later, inshallah. This is called a salam transaction. It has its own conditions. Now, the other type, here we're talking about it, is that when they conduct the sale on an item that is either not observed by both the seller and the buyer, or by one of them. And in that case, we have different sayings for the scholars regarding this type of transaction. So if someone were to say to you, you are looking for a car to buy, and he says to you, I have a car in the garage. I sell you the car in the garage for $10,000. So you haven't seen that car. You don't know what make or model that car is, what year it was made, what's the description. You know nothing about it. So you haven't seen that car. The owner of the car knows about it, everything. But the buyer doesn't know anything about it. So to conduct such type of transaction, on the car that is in the garage when the buyer doesn't know anything about it, such a transaction is invalid. And this is what Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu stated, and he said, because this goes under the selling of what includes a risk in it. They call this al-gharar in Arabic. So the risk is involved. Now here the risk, not finding the item as the buyer wants. So there is a risk. So he might pay that money. When he comes to take it, he might say, I didn't think it's, let us say, 2000 model. I thought it's 2010. So there is a risk. The dispute will arise in such a case because the buyer hasn't seen that item. And trust me, when you make sure that you conduct every contract according to the rules of the religion, both will be happy. No dispute will be found in such a case because everything has been agreed upon from the beginning. Some people, they say, and that's what they do, someone wants to hire someone to paint the house. He says to him, how much do you want for painting the house? The other one will say, we won't have any dispute about it. I said to them, this is the beginning of the dispute. That's the beginning of the dispute, is to say, we won't have any dispute about it. Now, Islamically, he's hiring your service to paint the house. So it has to be for a certain amount of money that is known. So if you don't specify, you don't mention for that price, it's invalid. Because what's going to happen? He's going to paint the house. Then you're going to ask him how much you want. He says $5,000. What? I thought you take $1,000. He says, no, for one room I take $1,000. Then you start having that dispute. Why the dispute has arisen in that case? Because of what? Because of no prior agreement on the price before conducting such a dealing. So that's why, if you want to avoid any type of dispute, make sure at the beginning you comply with the rules of the religion that renders such a dealing or transaction a valid one. Now, when they say that the item has not been observed, this means that if it has been observed, but at the time of conducting the contract, it wasn't present, here it is a valid transaction. That means you have seen that car, in the example that I've given, you have seen that car with the owner, you know that car, you know everything about it. Then later on, he was talking to you and he says to you, I need some money, whatever, whatever. I want to sell my car. Then you say, I buy it from you. You say, okay, I'll sell it to you for that price. You say, I accept. Then this is a valid transaction because you have seen it before. Although at the time of conducting the sale, it wasn't present, but it has been seen before. And there is a condition here that this item does not change a long time. Like, for instance, utensils. Utensils, usually, if you see them today, then after 5 days, after 1 week, usually they don't change. So you can buy this. Or the car. You see it today, after 2-3 days, whatever, they don't change. So you can buy this car even if it's not present at the time of conducting that sale. But if it's something that changes, like food, along the time, after 3 days, let us say they have bananas now, and he offered you to buy the bananas from him, you didn't buy them, then after a few days, if he says to you, I sell you the bananas that I've showed you 5 days ago, let us say, yeah, there is a risk. They might have rotted within that period of time. So that's why this item changes along the time. Here the scholars, when they said, even if the item is not present at the time of conducting the sale, they said, if it has been seen before and it does not change within that period of time, then the sale remains valid in that case. Now, other scholars said, selling an item that has not been observed before by the buyer, let us say, as I mentioned now, the seller would sell you a car in his garage. If he tells you, I now sell you my car that is in the garage, it's of that make, that model, that E, whatever. He mentions all the descriptions. It made that amount of kilometers and so on. He explained everything about the car. We said that according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, he says such a transaction, that's one of the sayings in the school of Imam Shafi'i, is invalid. However, other scholars, and another saying for Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, that such a transaction is valid provided that the buyer preserves the right to revoke the sale if the item was not found to be in accordance with the description. So let us say the seller sold you the car and he told you it's 2010 model. It's Toyota, for instance, and he told you about it. Then you accepted to buy it for that price without seeing it. Here, as a buyer, you have the right to revoke the sale if the item were to be found not agreeing with the description. So you went to check on it and you found that it's not in agreement with the description. Then you can say, I don't want it. Here the seller cannot say to you, but you agreed to buy it. Now here the buyer has the right of choice upon seeing the item. He can, if he find it in agreement with the description, then he won't be given the option of revoking the sale, because there is no risk, there is no harm in this case for the buyer. But if it were to be found different from the description, then it's up to the buyer either to keep going with this sale or to revoke it. It's up to him. Then Al-Qadi Abu Shuja said, it is valid to sell every item that is pure, beneficial, and is fully owned. Consequently, it is not valid to sell an item that is filthy, najis, or has no Islamically considerable benefit. Here now he's talking about, after talking about the seller and the buyer, what are the conditions that must be met in order for these parties to be entitled to conduct the sale. Now he's talking about the item that is set for sale. What are the conditions? He said, it is valid to sell any item that is pure. That's number one. So selling a filthy, najis item is invalid. Like selling wine, selling pork or ham, anything extracted from the pig, selling a dog, because the entity of the dog is filthy najis, so you cannot sell a dog, such as idols that are made by some people to be worshipped other than Allah, wal-'ayyazu billah. These idols cannot be sold as well. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that in the hadith narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. He said, Allah the Exalted forbade the selling of wine, the meat of dead animals that were not slaughtered according to the Islamic way, or they were not edible. So the meat of such an animal is filthy najis. The pig and the idols. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith made it clearly that these items cannot be sold. So even if you were to buy wine for other than the reason of drinking, you cannot have them through the transaction of selling and buying. You know what is in the wine? Mainly the alcohol. They call it the spirits. And that alcohol, you know how they use them now in some hospitals? They use the alcohol for other than drinking. They use them for injuries and the like, for wounds. So these cannot be obtained through buying and selling. They ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith, what about the fat of dead animals, meaning either unedible animals, or originally they are edible but they died without being slaughtered Islamically? So we call these maita. We call these animals here, these dead animals, maita. And it's najis, filthy najis. They said to the Prophet, what about the fat of the maita, these dead animals? People would buy the fat in order to light up the lantern with this fat. They use it as fuel for the lantern. And this is how they used to use it in the past. Or they paint the ships with them, the boats, the ships with them, because it makes a layer, it's like waterproofing. So they use it as waterproofing substance for the ships, or they might also use it for the leather. Also they use it for the leather. They ask the Prophet, what about buying the fat of dead animals so people can use them to light up the lantern with it, or to paint the ships or boats with them, or to cover the leather with them as well as a type of protection and the like? The Prophet said, no, it is still haram. So it is still forbidden. So even for other than eating them, you cannot have them through the way of selling and buying. So what about if you want the fat of the dead animal? You cannot buy them through selling and buying. You cannot have them through selling and buying, rather through donation. So you might donate the money, and that person will donate this fat for you. Donation, not through selling and buying. Now, if someone says, but I want to buy the dog for guarding, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed one to have a dog for the purpose of guarding. Yes, you can have the dog for guarding, but you cannot sell it or buy it. So you need to have it in other than the transaction of selling and buying. From here we understand that the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade these types of sales, because these items, wine, the maita, the dead body of an animal, either because it's not edible, or either it is edible but it was not slaughtered according to the Islamic way, so it died in other than this way, then you cannot buy it or sell it, and also the pig. And what is common between these three items is that they are all najis, filthy najis. So that's the reason why one is not allowed to sell him and buy him. Now there is something as well I would like to mention. In some countries, I know from our country, they sell blood of human beings. People will go to a place and donate blood. They put them in bags and they store them in what is called blood bank. There is something that is called a blood bank. If a person in need for 3 bags of A positive, B positive, whatever, he would go to that place and will tell him, I need 3 bags. Then they say to him, you have to pay such and such. Now selling the blood of a human being in this way is invalid. But if someone is sick, he needs an operation and they need that amount of blood, what do they do in that case? He can say to them, I'll give you money as donation and you give me these bags to use them. So he will donate the money, not in exchange of the blood. It's not for that reason. So it's gonna be as donation. Now, if this item that is filthy najis cannot be purified in any way, then you cannot sell it. Like what? Yogurt, when najasa falls in it, unexempted filthy najis falls in it, in the yogurt. Or in vinegar, then the vinegar and the yogurt becomes najis. Is there any way to purify it? No. There is no way. You cannot wash it. So you cannot purify it in that case. Oil. You have oil. Then let us say a mouse fell into it and died in it. That oil becomes najis. You cannot sell it. You cannot sell it. If it's something that is contaminated with filthy najis substance, however, it can be purified, like a piece of garment with najasa on it. Piece of garment with najasa on it. This can be purified, can be washed, and becomes pure. Then you can sell it because the other party can wash it and make it pure. So here, the entity of it originally is not najis. It has been contaminated with unexempted filthy najis substance. However, it can be purified. Then in that case, you can sell it. Also, the other types of fat that is solid, you know, the one that you use in cooking. If a mouse falls into it, what happens? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them the judgment. He said, if it is solid, it's not liquid, like oil, it's solid, then take it out and take an amount of the fat that came in contact with it from around it. So you take it out and you take something from around it, as for the rest you can still use them. But if it is liquid, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then throw it away. The scholar said, if there is a way for that liquid, let us say the fat that is liquid, like oil, if there is a way to purify it, the Prophet wouldn't have said throw it away because you're wasting money. But because there is no way in this case to purify it, that's why the Prophet said throw it away. And Allah knows best, we say La ilaha illallah 3 times.